workforce in this area. In December 2015, our Court of Appeals adopted our new Skills and Professional Values Admission Rule, which requires that applicants for admission to the New York State Bar establish that they have acquired the skills and are familiar with the professional values necessary to competently practice law. And of course, one of those values is pro bono service. New York is now the first state to require applicants to the bar to separately demonstrate that they have had essential practical skills training and gained sufficient understanding of professional values. Now, in adopting this rule, we did not provide an exhaustive list of skills and values necessary for practice, opting instead to rely as a starting point on the skills and values identified over the years by bar associations and legal educators. We found that various reports had formulated a detailed inventory of fundamental lawyering skills and professional values, and decided that those lists would serve as guideposts moving forward with the added benefit of promoting innovation in law schools and the development of pedagogical best practices for educating future lawyers. We also recognized that for this rule to work, and mind you, there was a great deal of pushback, as you can imagine. Nobody likes to do anything new, especially lawyers and especially law professors. Having been one, I can say that with certainty. The rule had to be flexible and allow for compliance through different avenues. Therefore, we created 5 pathways to facilitate individual compliance with the rule. 3 of these pathways focus on courses and work experiences completed during an applicant's legal education, and 2 allow an applicant to rely on practical experiences outside of law school. This, for us, reflected the realities of New York's diverse bar applicant pool, and that we have large numbers of both recent graduates or foreign lawyers seeking education. We're pleased to say that the law schools are now in the midst of figuring out how this will work, and I have great confidence that they're going to find their way. But in any event, law graduates always have the opportunity to do internships, and of course we encourage them to think about internships that are on behalf of those who are most needy, and we continue to encourage law schools to put money and resources into clinics that are benefiting those who are, again, most in need of services. Now, these are all important initiatives, but we understand that a change in mindset and affirmative policy is crucial if we hope to close the justice gap. One very recent example of local government enacting policy intended to address the need for legal assistance is the one we've just passed in New York City, working on access to justice in housing court. And it is New York City's local law 136, which guarantees legal representation to any low-income resident facing eviction. This is the first law in the nation to establish a right to counsel in housing cases. The rationale for the law is straightforward. About 97% of cases in housing court in New York City are brought by landlords who have counsel, 90% of the time, while tenants have counsel 1 to 10% of cases. Of course, there has been a call for this type of civil Gideon for some time, especially for housing matters because of the potential increase in homelessness, the disruption in the lives of adults and children when their living situation is uncertain, and because of the great disparity in bargaining position of tenants and landlords, which facilitates, unfortunately, in many ways, ensures unfair outcomes. The first version of the bill was introduced in 2014 and would provide attorneys for tenants and 125% of the poverty line faced eviction. The eligibility criteria was eventually raised to 200% in the final iteration of our bill. Concurrent with the development of this bill, in early 2016, the Office for Civil Justice was created to provide legal assistance to New Yorkers in need. The office is housed within our Human Resources Administration and is responsible for managing $70 million in free or low-cost legal assistance programs throughout New York City. In the 2017 financial year, $25.8 million went to anti-eviction legal services intended to serve 20,000 households each year. Additionally, $36 million in annual funding is dedicated to the Anti-Harassment Tenant Protection Program, which is, quote, aimed at preventing tenant harassment in communities that will be designated for rezoning. In other words, for those tenants who are the victims of gentrification. These are the two biggest programs administered by that Office of Civil Justice. Now getting back to the law, that local law provides that the coordinator of the Office of Civil Justice shall, by July 31st, 2022, so you can imagine, they are very busy because that year and that date is around the corner. They are responsible to establish a program to provide legal services for covered individuals, which the law defines. What the law defines is tenants in a rental dwelling unit in New York City, which is almost all of us, in covered proceedings in housing court, which are defined as eviction and non-payment or holdover proceedings. Indeed, the moment when a tenant is in crisis. Covered individuals will receive access to brief legal assistance, meaning a single consultation, no later than their first scheduled appearance in a covered proceeding in housing court, or soon thereafter as practical, and all income-eligible individuals will receive access to full legal representation, which means ongoing legal representation and all legal advice, advocacy, and assistance associated with such representation, no later than their first scheduled appearance in a covered proceeding in housing court, or soon thereafter is practical. We hope to end the experience of tenants not having spoken with a lawyer and being out the door before they even make it into the courthouse. All this costs money. Is this the 10th time I've said it? All this costs money. The program is currently funded at $77 million. Once the program fully phases in, it is expected to cost $155 million annually and handle 125,000 cases serving 400,000 New Yorkers facing eviction. It is already having substantial effects in 10 of the geographic zones targeted for special assistance. In those areas, those who are still uncertain about the success of this approach, in those areas, those geographic areas, the rate of representation in housing court has tripled from 16% in 2015 to 48% in 2017, reaching 23,000 households, which accounts for 70,000 New Yorkers. Since 2014, over 180,000 New Yorkers have already received support through New York's tenant legal services programs. Evictions by city marshals are down 27% from 2013, and we have also experienced decreases in eviction proceedings in housing court. 7% or 17,000 fewer cases since 2013. And every member of the bar and every judge knows how important it is to avoid a backlog in our judicial system. Meanwhile, actual substantive litigation in housing court has gone up with 19% more motions, 16% more emergency orders to show cause in 2016 as compared to 2014. Fewer cases going in, but more activity on the cases that exist, and that's not a bad thing. Because in other words, providing a lawyer to tenants leads to fewer eviction and more process. This is good news for New York City, and this is the goal of the program. The phase-in for New York's Universal Access Program will be 5 years. Funding has risen from $62 million last year to $77 million this year. Then we will gradually increase, finally reaching that $155.5 million target. The city is building a tenant support unit of 15 people to conduct outreach and plans to launch a multilingual paid advertising campaign to raise awareness, which is critical in New York where we have people who speak so many languages other than English. It expects to partner with local law schools, legal services providers, and the judiciary to develop a pipeline of housing lawyers and supervisors. More jobs for our graduates, more lawyers for those who need it, all good outcomes at the end of the day. We have hopes to integrate the Universal Access Program with the already extant anti-harassment and tenant protection program. Again, this is all heartening news. It shows us that working together, the bar, law schools, the legislative, executive, and judicial branch, all of us can solve the problem of the justice gap. We cannot get it done without lawyers and judges putting in the hours and resources to achieve that goal, because our justice system, frankly, is only as good as those who work in it. And the truth is that lawyers and judges have a special role in maintaining a fair and just legal system, focused on ensuring equality under the law, regardless of an individual's economic or political status, educational background, or class. By representing clients without financial resources and nowhere else to turn, lawyers literally secure their clients' day in court. And as former Chief Judge Lippman explained, if the judiciary keeps the courthouse doors open, we don't have equal justice inside, then justice does not mean anything. In other words, lawyers and judges are the true guardians of the guarantees of our Constitution and our legal system of just treatment under the law. We cannot ignore the reality of the justice gap and the harm it does to all of us and the values that we hold dear. So I thank all of you who make it possible for lawyers and our judiciary to help people and to ensure that the lawyers do that people like Mr. Blanchard and his family have an opportunity to be productive and enjoy the life that they live. Let me close with a saying that I have shared many times. Mostly I was a property professor. I hope you won't think less of me as a result. But mostly with my former property law students. I think it resonates with all of us who work in the legal profession, and certainly with all of you in this room who are doing this important work, and all of you who have financially and otherwise with your time supported that work. Service is the rent we pay on this earth. When time comes, let us not be found in arrears. Let us not be found with back unpaid rent. Thank you for inviting me to this breakfast and for all the work you do to make our system of justice a model in your home state, in our country, and in the world. Thank you.